A pleasant good night, TV viewers and radio listeners, to another segment of Let's Talk About It, the show that is informative and deals with the pressing issues of the day. I am your host, Ravey Gonzalez, with my co-host, Jaime Burns Jr.
Good night, all.
We're live on Channel 10, Nortevisión, Channel 17, CCV, Channel 61 on CBC, and 103.1 SCRS. A pleasant good night to all. Tonight's topic, we're going to deal with Petrocaribe. It's on everybody's mouth. Everybody has heard about petrodollars, petrotacos, petro this, petro that. And tonight we're going to deal with what is Petrocaribe. And to help me in explaining the fundamentals or the dynamics of how the system works, Mr. Burns will assist me in discussing the issue. Mr. Burns, good night. Welcome to the show.
Yes, again, good night to all. The Petrocaribe Agreement, as I'm sure almost every man, woman, and child across the country has probably uttered the phrase Petrocaribe rolling. But what exactly is Petrocaribe? What does it entail? First of all, it's a bilateral agreement between the government of Belize and the government of Venezuela. There are 8 key players, though, that are involved in this particular agreement. The main two being, of course, the government of Belize and the government of Venezuela.
But not interrupt you, Jaime, but why would the country of Venezuela want to give Belize this access to this money? I mean, I think a backdrop to why there is this whole Petrocaribe. We know that Petro comes from petroleum, oil. Caribe means the Caribbean, this Petrocaribe. But why do we have this in place? So before you get into the dynamics of how it works, people want to know, what is this Petrocaribe? How did it come about? Is it something only Belize can access? Is it something that our neighbors can access? Is this something that Venezuela has offered to somebody else? Why did Venezuela offer it in the first place? So perhaps so that people will get the backdrop as to why we have access to this Petrocaribe money. Perhaps maybe we can start at that point.
Well, from that point, I think a proper place to start would be to mention that it was Hugo Chavez's vision to improve the socioeconomic state and standards of his Latin American and Caribbean neighbors. And at his avail is the production of petroleum. You know, Venezuela is the fifth largest manufacturer of petroleum in the world. And what he did to effect such improvement is to enact the Petrocaribe Agreement with several Caribbean and Latin American countries. Belize is one of those countries.
Okay, so this is the late Commandant Hugo Chavez's legacy. This is his vision of helping his neighbors, his vision of uniting people by using one thing that they have a lot of, which is oil. Am I right in saying that this is what he attempted to do? He wanted to use oil as a way of reaching out to his neighbors and telling them, you know, we can improve the standard of living of our neighbors. We can use oil to bring benefits to the people who accept Petrocaribe agreements?
Absolutely, and it's not only by way of the oil or the petroleum itself, but more so from the funds that come from the sale of that. And in particular, the agreement between Belize and Venezuela, the Petrocaribe Agreement, is for the direct sale from Venezuela to Belize of petroleum products. And these include diesel, gasoline, residual fuel oil, and crude oil, and even lubricants. And the sale is on concessionary financing terms, which means that the sales are at market price, because Venezuela has OPEC obligations and so the sale, the, no discounts are actually given.
Okay, so before we get into how the mechanism works, we want the people to understand that this was the late Hugo Chavez's extension of like an offer to not only Belize but other countries, telling them, if you accept my offer of accepting oil from Venezuela, you will have access to a particular portion of the money that you would have paid. So we want the population of Belize to understand that it was an offer to Hugo Chavez, and not only to Belize. It was offered to certain Latin American countries and the Caribbean. Is that so?
That is so.
Because a lot of people wonder, well, where is this Petro-Caribbean money coming from?
It's a regional initiative.
And the legacy of Hugo Chavez in order to his neighboring countries, in order to help societies, help the standard of living from neighboring countries, those that accept Petro-Caribbean agreements.
Well, yes, his vision was biblical even in that, you know, you must do unto others as you would like to be done unto you. And he would like to have seen his neighboring countries, both Latin American and Caribbean again, improve, as would he want Venezuela to. So in that effort, Petro-Caribbean was born.
Came about, okay. And Belize became
One of the signatories.
Signatories, okay. When did this come in play? When did Belize agree to this Petro-Caribbean agreement?
Initially in 2005.
2005. And how the viewers and the listeners might want to know, okay, I understand that the late Hugo Chavez wanted to help Belize. Now, the next question that follows, how does Venezuela sending oil to Belize benefits the people of Belize or benefits the government of Belize? So perhaps where you had you were mentioning of who are the players,
the
involved.
Players involved.
How does it work? Okay, maybe you could explain it from that point of view.
Certainly, but first, to put it succinctly, we do purchase petroleum from Venezuela as per the agreement, but we do not pay the entire price up front. A portion of what we pay is retained by Belize, and that therein forms the funds from which we have a Petro-Caribbean loan. And the players involved in these transactions are, like I said, the government of Venezuela and the government of Belize. And there's a company called PDVSA, which is a state-owned oil company of Venezuela. And they are responsible for undertaking all petroleum-related activities in Venezuela. There's a subsidiary of that company called PDV Caribe. And they are responsible solely for managing Petro-Caribe contracts with the member states, therefore managing Petro-Caribe contracts with Belize. There's BPEL, which is Belize Petroleum and Energy Limited. That was Belize's state-owned energy company. And that was set up in August of 2005 when Petro-Caribbean was initially introduced in Belize. And that was introduced to administer, to oversee the Petro-Caribbean program locally in Belize and to transact with the state-owned Venezuelan company, the PDVSA, and other entities engaged in delivering Petro-Caribbean oil to Belize. However, between 2005 and 2009, the Petro-Caribbean program fizzled out, and it was revamped in 2012, where a company called Upbel was formed. And for those of you familiar with Belize City, they actually have an office at the end of Coney Drive. Upbel, it stands for Alba Petro-Caribbean Belize Energy Limited, and that's a joint venture between PDV Caribe, which is the Venezuelan state-owned subsidiary, and BPEL, and their ownership goes 55% for Venezuela and 45% for Belize. And they were set up to promote and facilitate the cooperation between Belize and Venezuela in undertaking local matters and enterprises that touched and concerned and flowed from Petrocaribe. Then there are all the other three player, the other two players rather, sorry, are two companies. One is Trafigura and the other is Puma Energy Belize. Trafigura is a company designated by the government of Belize to purchase petroleum products from Venezuela. So they are the purchasers. Puma Energy Belize is the company who actually imports and distributes the petroleum locally here in Belize. So collectively, these companies, to put it simply, form the conduit through which petroleum is purchased, brought to Belize, and distributed. The money, as I mentioned previously, where the money comes from, where the Petrocaribe rolling money comes from, is that we do not pay the full price for the petroleum up front. We pay a percentage, and the percentage that remains in Belize and eventually forms a part of the consolidated revenue fund of the government of Belize to be spent on social and economic ventures and projects.
Okay, so to explain it in small change, we have the government of Venezuela and the government of Belize getting into an agreement. However, to carry out this agreement, they need other players to do it.
Yes, you need a channel.
A channel. In Venezuela, there is the PDVSA.
Yes.
This company. It's a state-owned. State-owned means that it belongs to the government of Guatemala as opposed to a private owner. So this state-owned company deals with Venezuela's marketing, selling, exporting, refining, and drilling of oil. We're concerned here with the export aspect of PDVSA. However, below this company that belongs to Venezuela, there is another company, a lower company, a subsidiary.
A subsidiary.
And the job of this subsidiary is strictly to deal with the Petrocaribe agreement.
Yes, PDVSA deals with everything petroleum related in Venezuela. While the subsidiary you just mentioned, PDV Caribe, is Petrocaribe centric. It deals only with matters relating to Petrocaribe.
Okay, so we would say that PDVSA is the company, state-owned company, that would sell to other countries who do not have a Petrocaribe agreement, while this subsidiary, PDV Caribe, is the subsidiary company that would deal specifically with those countries who have signed agreement with Venezuela under the Petrocaribe agreement.
Exactly.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we're through with our first part of Let's Talk About It. Very interesting topic. We're trying to find out, or we're finding out, how the Petrocaribe agreement came about, who are the players, how does Belize benefit. So we're going to our first commercial break. I invite you to stay tuned as we continue our discussion on Petrocaribe.
UDP, we're transforming Belize.
Attention all supporters and sympathizers of the United Democratic Party. It's the Grand UDP Nomination Day this Friday, October 16th. Nominations for Gaspar Vega, Lupe Magaña, Elodio Aragon Jr., and for Danny Grijalva. Orange Walk North will meet at Trial Farm Village and then parade into town. Orange Walk South will parade from the Belize Sugarcane Farmers area on San Antonio Road. Orange Walk East will meet at Liberty Avenue and then parade into town. Orange Walk Central will meet at the UDP office on San Francisco Street and then parade into town. Everyone is asked to assemble in their respective area by 1 p.m. After the nomination nations, there will be a grand UDP rally at Banquitas. There will be speeches by the four UDP candidates, followed by a free jump up with Captain Robbie, TR Shine, and much more. There will be free food and drinks for everyone. Come one, come all to this grand UDP event. Dress in your UDP colors. Bring out your UDP flags on Friday, October 16th. It's nomination day. See you there. UDP, the best is yet to come.
UDP, the confident win. UDP, the confident win. UDP countrywide.
Son?
Yes, Dad?
I think it's time we have the talk. I believe you're old enough now, son. I know it's your first time. I know this talk might be uncomfortable. But you have to be smart, careful, you have to protect yourself. This can affect your future, son. It's not all about what you could get out of it. It's about making the right choice. Have you decided who you'll vote for?
Don't worry, Dad. You've raised me right. I will vote for the UDP.
Alright, that's my boy.
Orange Walk, UDP East Standard Bearer, Elodio Aragon Jr., Son of the East, the true leader of the East, with commitment and desire for a betterment for his people, has begun the transformation. As Standard Bearer of the East, Elodio Aragon Jr. has proven by action and vision, not by words and promises, that he is the true leader of the East. In the Louisiana and Tongue areas, he has renovated the sporting facilities such as the basketball court and football field and installed new dugouts for all athletes. He has built from the ground up new bathroom facilities with bleachers for all to benefit. He revitalized the East Sports Center and made it great again. He has uplifted all roads in the Pasadena area, in which no other era Standard Bearer had done. In the village of Palmar, Chan Pine Ridge, Tower Hill, Carmelita, and Santa Marta, Elodio Aragon Jr., Son of the East, in his quest to serve the people of the East, has built new bleachers, bathroom, and sporting facilities, and installed community centers, and provided healthcare for all to benefit. With his vision and a desire to prosper, he has proven with limited resources to uplift majority of the roads in all the East villages and town areas. A true leader of the East, Elodio Aragon Jr., Son of the East, a man of action and vision, has proven through deeds and not words that he is the best candidate for the East. So come November 4th, vote Elodio Aragon Jr., Son of the East.
Good night, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to Let's Talk About It. Tonight's topic is Petrocaribe. We were discussing how does Petrocaribe benefit the people of Belize? How did it come about? And we were discussing before the commercial break, how is it that the arrangement is structured, that oil is sent from Venezuela and comes to the shores of Belize? What is the mechanism that is used so that Venezuela can channel the oils to Belize? We know that there is a state-owned company, PDVSA, in Venezuela, who is responsible for all oil-related activities in Venezuela, and that company has a subsidiary company called PDV Caribe, which is the company in Venezuela that works out the logistics when it comes to the Petrocaribe contracts, which Belize signed with Guatemala in 2005. We know that, as Mr. Burns was explaining, that we have a joint venture, a company in Belize called APBEL, that is 55% owned by Venezuela, which is the PDV Caribe, and 45% owned by BPEL. Simply, without all the alphabets, it is a company that is designated to receive and to work out the logistics of the Petro-Caribe agreement between Venezuela and Belize. So as we were talking, this was an initiative by the late Hugo Chavez to assist neighboring countries. It was an offer so that people can have, the countries can have access to money. We're just about to discuss how is it that sending oil to countries that participate in the Petro-Caribe agreement, how is it that this shipment of oil converts to money and how it converts to benefit for those governments that participate under the Petro-Caribe initiative or the Petro-Caribe agreement. So Jaime, if you can take it from there, we know that Belize has signed an agreement in 2005. We know there was a period between 2005 and 2007, I believe, in which there was a hiatus, for lack of a better word, the agreement was in suspense or suspended informally because the vision of Hugo Chavez of making the benefit of the Petro-Caribe reach the masses was not happening. At least that is what is in part of their report. But we have seen a surge of benefits. We have seen a surge of activities, of government spending. We've heard about Petro-Caribe spending, especially since 2008. So how do these barrels of oil turn or convert to benefit, to money for the people of Belize?
Well, what the agreement provides for is for a portion of each invoice of every product brought in, remember, gasoline, diesel, lubricants, every invoice for every shipment of products, a portion is called the financed portion. And that portion is not paid immediately. What is paid immediately is called the cash portion. And that is paid, the cash portion is payable within 90 days. So let's say we receive a shipment of petroleum from Venezuela. It costs $100 for the entire shipment, metaphorically, of course. A portion called the cash portion is payable within 90 days with a financing charge of 2% per annum levied after 30 days. So how that works is when the market price of oil is $40 per barrel. When it goes below $40 or 40 and below, it is paid at 15 years at a 2% interest rate with a 2-year grace period. And if it goes above, then the payment period of the financing portion is then extended to 25 years at a 1% interest rate.
Okay, so let's digest that properly. The offer is, because Venezuela is a member of OPEC, is the organization of petroleum exporting countries. And they are obligated to sell
at the market, at the global market price.
Global market value. So they just can't come and give us discount on the barrel of oil. They have to sell it to us.
Yes.
But the offer is then that once the price of the barrel of crude oil is $40 or less,
$40 US dollars
or less, Venezuela is telling us, I only need to pay up a portion, of the price of the barrel, and the rest, I don't need to pay it until 15 years later at an interest rate of 2%. But you're also saying that if the price of the crude oil, the barrel of crude oil, should jump $40 US, that then the terms of the agreement There's another term that governs that, the payment plan is that we only need to pay a percentage over 25 years yes. instead of the 15, and it is reduced to 1%.
Yes.
Okay, so 40 and below is 15 years at 2%, $40 or more.
Over 40.
Over $40, it's 25 years at 1%.
Exactly. Quite.
So, would I be right in saying then that the agreement in terms of what Belize or how much Belize benefits is based on the price of the barrel of crude oil in the world?
Very much so. That's a very, very valid point, because as the price increases, so then does the availability of the financing portion, which again is the portion that remains in Belize and forms a part of the Petrocaribe loans, so to speak. So if the price increases to $50 per barrel, then the portion is therefore greater than it would be if the price was $30. More stays. We pay more upfront, the portion we must pay, the cash portion, but the financing portion, which remains in Belize, which the government will be able to spend on social and economic enterprises and projects, is also greater. And that's also the portion that we pay not over 15 years, but we have 25 years. And it's only at 1% interest, 1%.
So the scale is the higher the price of the barrel of crude oil, the more, the less we have to pay up front, naturally, because the price of crude oil has gone up. And
yes.
then the lower the price of crude oil, then it's more money we have to pay up front and less money stays available for financing.
Yes.
Okay, could you explain to our viewers and radio listeners as to what percentage we're talking about, so that they could have an idea how the scale works? I think some people would want to know. But also, before we do that, we also have to clarify that neither the government of Belize and neither the government of Venezuela have control over the world market, world prices of crude oil. So basically, it's none of these countries that can independently or arbitrarily determine what are the terms of this agreement, whether it is 15 years or whether it is 25 years at 1%. Basically, the agreement is saying it is pegged to the world market.
Yes, because the world market itself is unpredictable in its fluctuations. The global price of oil, of petroleum, it varies from time to time, which should be common knowledge. For we all go to the gas pumps, and it even if it's a matter of cents, it still fluctuates. It's never pegged, as you say, at one price.
The reason I'm asking is because I've heard rumors, you know, people saying, well, the government of the day has spent all the Petrocaribe money. You know, that about trying to frighten people that somehow this was like a set limit to Petrocaribe in terms of money.
And that the funds have been depleted.
And depleted, and it was like a set amount. Mm-hmm. So I'm trying to clarify that, because the price of oil today is what, $46.65.
That's
so
today's price.
We're still over the threshold of $40, which means that should any shipment of petroleum come in
today,
we would still benefit of the 25 years concessionary loan. Sorry, go ahead.
No, if we had received any shipments today at the price of $46.65, which is today's global market price, then the financing portion, again, the portion that remains in Belize, that will be repayable over the 25-year span instead of the 15-year. And the interest rate will be only at 1%.
Yes, yes, because then what should happen? Because we know over a year ago, the viewers, some of the viewers might know, over a year ago, the price of the crude oil, the barrel of crude oil was over $100. And maybe if you look at those prices, although our fuel pump prices go up, the government of the day benefits more because there is more portion of the shipment that is left to finance in order to projects, in order to do projects. So let us say that the government of Venezuela does not withdraw this offer, and should the price of the barrel of crude oil go up tomorrow to $100, what are the implications of that in terms of the benefit?
In terms of the benefit, should the price spike to $100, the financing portion, the portion that remains in Belize to form, to eventually form part of the government's consolidated revenue fund, will be greater than if it were at 46, 65, like it was today. So we would then have more funds at our disposal to spend on projects of social and economic priority, as is quite vivid if you step out your door today living in Belize.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm talking with Jaime Burns Jr. discussing Petrocaribe and how the financing portion of the shipments benefit the people of Belize or provide the government of the day access to money to invest in the people of Belize. But we're going for a short break. I invite you to come back as we continue the discussion as we get into more of Petrocaribe.
Porque ya me cansé de estar rentando y así nadie me va a sacar de mi casa.
Well, I feel glad. Thanks to Mr. Vega. Because now I know I'm parent, no.
I thank God for everything. After 3 years, you know, two, 3 years I apply. So God finally answered my prayers. You know, and I thank Mr. Vega too because he always is there for everybody. And I pray that God give him the health and strength for finish the way he did do. You know, and then election they come close, you know, and don't worry, he going back in.
The residents of Coyoakville also received their lease certificate in August of 2014.
Me siento bien contento y ese es un día muy especial, inolvidable. Sí, porque hemos recibido el título vamos a decir.
Alegre, contenta por lo que ha hecho Mr. Vega con nosotros. Ajá, me siento bastante alegre, porque lo que antes no tenía, hoy lo tengo.
Ahorita estoy alegre porque el gobierno es el único que te puede gratificar un terreno.
The honorable Gaspar Vega, proven leader, working with his people, for his people.
UDP, we're transforming Belize.
Attention all supporters and sympathizers of the United Democratic Party. It's the Grand UDP Nomination Day this Friday, October 16th. Nominations for Gaspar Vega, Lupe Magana, Elodio Aragon Jr., and for Denny Grijalva. Orange Walk North will meet at Trial Farm Village and then parade into town. Orange Walk South will parade from the Belize Sugarcane Farmers area on San Antonio Road. Orange Walk East will meet at Liberty Avenue and then parade into town. Orange Walk Central will meet at the UDP office on San Francisco Street and then parade into town. Everyone is asked to assemble in their respective area by 1 p.m. After the nominations, there will be a grand UDP rally at Banquitas. There will be speeches by the four UDP candidates, followed by a free jump up with Captain Robbie, TR Shine, and much more. There will be free food and drinks for everyone. Come one, come all to this grand UDP event. Dress in your UDP colors. Bring out your UDP flags on Friday, October 16th. It's nomination day. See you there. UDP, the best is yet to come.
UDP, the confident win. UDP, the confident win. UDP countrywide.
good night, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to another segment of Let's Talk About It. Tonight's topic is Petrocaribe. We have discussed how it came about under the auspices of the late Commandant Hugo Chavez, his initiative to help his neighboring countries. We know that Venezuela is one of the fifth largest oil exporting countries, and he wanted to use that resource to assist his neighboring countries. Belize signed on to the agreement in 2005, saying we want to be part of the Petrocaribe Agreement. We have discussed that the agreement is pegged to the price of the barrel of crude oil. The higher the price of crude oil, the more the larger portion of financing is available for the government of Belize. The lower the price of crude oil, in particularly when the price of crude oil drops below $40, the loan facility is only to 15 years at 2%, as opposed to 25 years at 2%.
At 1%.
When the price of crude oil jumps $40 per the price of crude oil. So, Jaime, we were talking about the price of crude oil is 46.65 cents today. So Belize is still benefiting from the Petrocaribe Agreement.
Yes, we still are.
So this rumor about how it is finished is a lie. Because every shipment that comes in, there is a portion that we can access in terms of financing.
Yes, very much so.
Okay, so we move on. What was the purpose of the monies being lent to these countries under the Petrocaribe Agreement?
Well, the Petrocaribe Agreement, the very agreement itself, is aimed to integrate Caribbean peoples through the sovereign use of natural and energy resources, that is petroleum and other sources of energy, in direct benefit of its citizens. Now, we must accept that as a people, we perpetuate a culture of instant gratification. The Caribbean citizens on a whole, I'll venture to say, we are most happy when we actually see development, when we see progress. We like tactile progress. We don't want to hear about progress as much as we love to see progress. So what this is aimed at is to invest in bringing such progressive endeavors to light, in making the intangible tangible.
Yes, definitely. So the agreement is for the use of government of Belize to improve lives.
Yes.
That was the agreement, part of the agreement.
And it's also to consolidate and strengthen the very relationship between Belize ourselves and Venezuela.
Okay. So how do you improve people's lives? How do you take this money and say, I will improve the lives of Belizean? I guess one of the first thing that jumps at you, one of the issues that is always in the forefront, is the issue of jobs. People want jobs.
Yes.
People want to earn their salary. People want to be able to be independent. People want to be able to provide for their family. They want to be able to go to the shop and be able to pay with the income that they have earned. So one of the methods in improving the lives of Belizeans is to give jobs. And the use of the Petrocaribe monies through the use of, or through the infrastructure work, is one of the many ways in which the people of Belize are benefiting from the Petrocaribe monies.
Yes, very much so.
So all the street works that we're seeing in the country of Belize, the building of bridges,
the highways,
are projects that require labor.
Yes.
Require people to be employed.
Yes. Yes, they're very, very personnel intensive.
And labor intensive. So we know that people are benefiting directly from the Petro-Caribbean monies.
Yes.
Okay, so we understand that the monies are there for the government to use to change the lives of people, to improve the lives of people.
The socioeconomic state of the country.
Socioeconomic state. What do you mean by that?
Well, socioeconomic, both social and our economic atmosphere. The Petro-Caribbean Agreement is aimed at improving both. And you improve a nation's economy, you improve its society.
Right.
That should be the logical consequence.
People have jobs, they don't see, well, they won't have the urgent need to get into crimes, robbery, I mean, theft, well, if people are employed.
Well, it may very much serve as a deterrence, but how I would rather look at it is that aside from jobs, a parallel priority to jobs is that of education. And people have jobs, people start becoming educated. So the injection of Petro-Caribbean funds into the Belizean workforce will ripple into the education, into education rather, and into many other industries. You put money into the economy, money goes around.
Trickles down. They call the multiplier effect, right? People earn their salary, they spend the salary at the store, the store realizes they're selling more,
they order
more stuff, they make more money in terms of their profit, they have more purchasing power. So, we understand works is one way, infrastructure is one way in which Petro-Caribbean is benefiting the people of Orange Walk. We have works in Belize City, for example.
Yes, certainly.
Belize City, I think nobody can dispute the type of development that has happened in Belize City. It is a glaring example of how, when money is properly used.
I personally drove through the city lately, last month, I believe, and I was impressed at the level of work I saw and the work that had been done up until that point allowed for me to see where the direction of this progress, and it's a direction that I very much like.
Right, so besides the aspect of employment, people actually working to get the road done. In Orange Walk, for example, of this Petro-Caribbean monies, $2 million was spent on the San Antonio Road.
Yes.
And for those who have traveled the San Antonio Road, it is hot mixed, very good quality. It has the nice markers on the side of the road, and it has the drainage where it's necessary. So
it has been, as regards the San Antonio Road, the comment has been made to me personally ample times that the San Antonio Road is like state's road.
But I mean, yes, we have accepted that people employed to get the street done is good for the economy because you provide jobs, people have money, people spend. As well though, I can speak firsthand because I live on San Antonio Road. The amount of vehicular traffic that has increased, the number of people that now travel to the south of Orange Walk is made much, much easier. It's almost like you're encouraging a local tourism in Orange Walk. People from town find it easier to travel to the villages down south, to circle, to take a look of what is Blue Creek and San Felipe, San Lazaro, Agaspine Ridge.
It's a very, very scenic drive.
Right. So I'm saying besides the beneficial aspect of the, in terms of labor, in terms of employment, it also creates an environment where people can move freely, easier, and it changes the way one looks at one's town. one, the way that one looks at one city. I could imagine the residents of Belize City as well are proud of the fact that Belize City has transformed in this manner.
It certainly improves civic pride.
But beside that, we know that the Petrocaribe money as well was used to buy equity in the
National Bank
yes. of Belize.
Yes.
Now we have a Bank of Belize, yes, National Bank of Belize, where people can access loans at very, very low rates.
Very low rates.
Now, first thing that jumps at, well, you have to pay back these monies at 1%. But now
the Petrocaribe monies.
The Petrocaribe
yes.
monies.
Yes.
You start a bank, and you're saying, because remember, before the National Bank of Belize, interest rates were 12%, 13%, and yes. there had to be some outlet, some way.
Housing loans, I believe.
Housing.
Or at those rates.
Loans, yes. I believe so. Mm-hmm. There had to be some way in which the people of Belize could access loans at a cheaper rate. Why not give them the availability of borrowing money at a much cheaper rate? I believe it's 5.5
or 6.5. I believe it's 5.5 or 6.
So you're saying, look here, we see the Petrocaribe money, fine, where they build streets, where they give people job. Those that are teachers, those that are soldiers, those that want the little house improvement or want a little loan to send their kids to school, we're telling them, here, you can benefit from the Petrocaribe too by
directly
going to this bank and borrowing. So the manner in which the benefit of the Petrocaribe transitions into the lives of Belizeans is through different avenues.
Yes.
We also have the CXC.
Yes, like I said, to me, and I believe across the country, education is a parallel priority to jobs. It should be the utmost priority, education.
Okay, so we're saying then, when government takes the initiative to pay for these CXC exams, telling the students, you know, telling the parents or the guardians, whoever is the one that is burdened with the bill of paying CXC, government is telling them, don't worry about that. All you need to do is study and pass your exams. Government, through the Petrocaribe money, is going to help you to pay for these CXCs so that when you apply for a job, you can have your results included in your resume, or when you apply for a scholarship, or when you apply to go to a tertiary institution, that it's not because of lack of money, your parents or guardian, you couldn't sit the exam.
Yes, you're not hindered by a lack of funds to sit your CXCs.
Right, so that is another way in which the Petrocaribe money is assisting the people of Belize. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going for another break. Stay tuned as we continue our discussion with Petrocaribe, how it was formed, what is the agreement, and how it is benefiting the people of Belize. Stay tuned.
If I hear the saying, who will bring new? Well, that's exactly what's happening when you come to Digicel. Bring in your old tired smartphone and watch us bring out our new fabulous Digicel 4G phone. And not just that, you get 1 free gig of 4G data, a free SIM card, and $50 free credit too. Just bring a working, active smartphone, and depending on how much you talk, you could get $70 to as much as $300 towards your new Digicel phone. With credit, with data, and with a SIM card. Trade in, trade up, and get more with Digicel.
Get more, do more, love more, live more with Digicel.
Son?
Yes, Dad?
I think it's time we have the talk. I believe you're old enough now, son. I know it's your first time. I know this talk might be uncomfortable. But you have to be smart, careful, you have to protect yourself. This can affect your future, son. It's not all about what you could get out of it. It's about making the right choice. Have you decided who you'll vote for?
Don't worry, Dad. You've raised me right. I will vote for the UDP.
All right. That's my boy.
Good night, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to Let's Talk About It. We have been having our discussion tonight on the topic of Petrocaribe. Everybody is talking about it. People want to know where is this money coming from? Is this money finished? Who is giving us this money? What are the rates? What are the terms? How has Belize benefited out of it? Will we continue to benefit out of it? Is it something that is good or bad for Belize? So welcome back. I'm your host, Rave Gonzalez, with my co-host, Jaime Burns. So Jaime, before we went to the break, we were talking about the benefits of Petrocaribe monies, that government has taken monies to do infrastructure work, which we know is, gives direct employment to people, as well it builds up the community. You have better streets, better bridges, you have more roads. We know that the Petrocaribe has been used to finance the National Bank of Belize, where yes, people can now access loans at a much cheaper rate. And in fact, I would venture to say is one of the primary reasons why the interest rates have become so competitive among commercial banks, because people need to compete, they need to lower their rates so that the Belizeans benefit the most out of it. We've also talked about how certain Petrocaribe funds have been used for the payment of CXCs for students in Ford Farm, which is a great initiative. There's so many projects that listing them off, besides being tedious, would take a larger section of the show, which we did not target for tonight. But having said that, monies are being spent on the people of Belize. Some are saying, well, there was an issue out there saying, well, yes, but there needs to be some sort of accountability. You know, people have their concerns about, because we have to pay it back. It is
a loan,
yes, which was initially thought to be a credit facility. Mm-hmm. But what, in your view, has been the concern that brought up the Petrocaribe Act? And maybe perhaps you could explain the Petrocaribe Act in order for your viewers to familiarize themselves with it.
Well, the Petrocaribe Act was passed in 2015, and it was aimed at governing the funds and providing a mechanism for its accountability.
Okay, so we know that we have an Finance and Audit Reform Act, which basically it is this act that was passed in 2005, I believe, because of the then administration and the manner in which they were recklessly, I would use that word, spending. The social partners came up with this act along with the government in order to make sure that there is this type of accountability by the government of the day. And there was this concern about whether the monies coming from Petrocaribe was a loan that had to go to the house, or wasn't it a loan? Because remember, the way it worked is Venezuela sends the oil, but you don't pay back everything. So it is not government.
You pay back the cash portion.
The cash portion.
And the financing portion is what is retained in Belize. And therein lies the source of the Petrocaribe funds.
So it is not until the shipment comes in that you would know, or when they send the shipment, that you would know how much or what portion of the shipment would be the part that is financed.
Exactly. And again, on the point of fluctuating global prices, it is up until the day of purchase and importation that you know what exactly to the cent you'll be paying for that barrel of petroleum.
So
you can't take to the House of Representatives an exact figure beforehand, because as you had mentioned earlier in the show, neither Belize nor Venezuela, as sovereign states, neither can dictate the global market price of petroleum. Neither can. We are obedient to the market. Therefore, we cannot tell you what the market price of petroleum will be next week. So we can't go to the House this week and say, well, Petrocaribe funds for the next month will reap in so and so to the cent. It's somewhat unpredictable in that sense, in terms of getting it down to a perfect decimal.
So, well, the Petrocaribe Act that was passed in 2015 was, regardless if your definition is whether it's a loan or a credit facility, because the Finance and Audit Act says that prior to the loan you have to get approval, and if you don't know the amount, then it's kind of difficult to determine for what amount you're going to go to the House to get approval for. Nevertheless, the Act is there, and the Act is there to govern the expenses and the way the government uses those funds in terms of getting the House to approve it. Now, the Act, as amended, requires government quarterly to bring to the House the amount spent for that quarter and get the approval.
Get a retrospective approval.
Retrospective approval.
As the amendment states, yes.
So, they still have to disclose it to the House, the amount that they are spending.
Yes, the Petrocaribe funds and their expenditure are publicly disclosed to the House of Representatives and ergo to the people of Belize.
Okay, so when it comes to the accountability, there is disclosure. That is my point. I want to make that point that it is not something hidden in one ministry where nobody knows what is happening. It is something that after the quarterly session of the year, quarterly, government has to come to the House and say, bam, see ya, this is what I spent. This is what I spent it on. And the House will have a time to look at it, discuss it, debate it if they want. The thing is, the information will be there so that everybody could chew it.
Exactly. If, like I said, the financing portion, which forms the funds of the Petrocaribe loan, they are eventually funneled into the government's account at Central Bank. Now, Central Bank, as a banking institution, must have reports of each and every single transaction. And furthermore, these funds are governed by the Ministry of Finance, which also, of its own accord and by its own obligations, must produce quarterly, I believe, and definitely annual reports. So all these reports lend to the cohesive and entire accountability of Petrocaribe funds.
So Jaime, before we go to the end of the show, what, in your opinion, is the future of Petrocaribe?
Only until Venezuela decides to retract or renege on the Petrocaribe agreement, and I do not foresee that at all. Most definitely not in the immediate future. I see the Petrocaribe agreement as a means through which Belize and the Belizean people in particular can see the hopes of progress become tangible, tactile statues of development.
Because we know that in the settlement of BTL, there was 19 million of the Petro-Caribe used for the initial payment of the Petro-Caribe settlement.
Yes.
So, in that manner, isn't the use of the Petro-Caribe in order to secure public utility in the name of the government of Belize, or rather in the name of BTL, where government is the majority shareholder?
And by government, the people of Belize.
Right. That in itself is a benefit to the people of Belize.
It's a great benefit.
And I also heard the government of Belize put forward that they will use Petro-Caribe monies to buy back the super bond.
Yes, because eventually, amidst all this expenditure on infrastructure, jobs, education, there must also be any prudent administration will make sure that there is some debt buyback. So some of the Petro-Caribe funds must be allocated to debt buyback and to paying back the super bond.
So in mathematical terms, instead of you owe your creditor 4 to 6% of the super bond, every bullet payment that you have to pay.
Yes.
You pay that off so that you only owe 1%.
Yes, because the super bond, as you rightly said, is accruing at a 4 to 6, sometimes 7% interest rate. Whereas, again, Petro-Caribe can either be 15 years at 2% if the price of a barrel of oil is $40 or below, or it's repaid at 25 years at 1% if it's above $40. So in terms of weighing your options, 1% in opposition to 4 to 7%. You try to pay the super bond off and finance through Petro-Caribe.
The country is in a better economic position.
Certainly.
In terms of its debt, its foreign loans and debts. Ladies and gentlemen, we have had our discussion tonight on Petro-Caribe. We have tried to, as succinctly as possible, discussed how it came about, how it works, how Belize benefits money, how money comes into Belize City, the country of Belize, how government has access to this money, how the government has to declare these monies by the Petro-Caribe Act, and the future of Petro-Caribe. Once it's an offer by the government of Venezuela, it is a good offer. It is an offer for the government of the day to make the most, so that it impacts the lives of the Belizean people. So, Jaime, any parting shots before we leave?
I'd like to invite you all to join us next week, where we will attempt to tap into the pulse of the youth. We will have a few vibrant first-time voters with us, and we will discuss issues pertinent to their concerns. So be sure to tune in the same time next week, and you can catch the replay of this show Thursday night at 8 o'clock.
So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you again for watching the show. It has been very, very entertaining and informative. We'd like to thank Maurice Kokom, the director, Raheem Wagner, our video controls and graphics coordinator, and Mr. Esquiliano, our audio technician, for assisting us tonight. Mr. Burns, for being here with us as we discuss the issues. So again, tune in next week as we bring another segment of Let's Talk About It. A pleasant good night to all.